the Lord. أشهد أن محمد رسول الله. أشهد أن محمد رسول الله. حي الصلاة. حي الصلاة.
Descendants, his companions, the Muslims, the believers, the followers, all throughout the world, and all that follows in this excellent salutation, dear believers of Allah. Bismillahi ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. We always say before we read the Quran, but even before that, we say, and we should say silent, أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم. I seek refuge from the accursed Satan with Allah. But we should say that silently. We don't have to preach about Satan and give him so much attention in the world. Sometimes you go to goodbyes and that's all they talk about. It's Satan, but they don't point Satan out. They don't point Satan out in their life. Then we say, Bismillahi ar-Rahman ar-Rahim, with Allah's name, the merciful benefactor, the merciful redeemer. And then we pause, because Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim is not a part of the next verse. So we pause. We pause between A'udhu Billahi. We pause and we say Bismillah and we pause. And sometimes we should remember to say at least Bismillah when we are conscious of our intentions. That brings us consciousness when we say Bismillah. Then Allah says, خَلَقَ السَّمَوَاتِ وَالْأَرْضَ, that he created the heavens, the skies, more than one sky, seven skies. He created the skies and the earth, بِالْحَقِّ, with truth and reality. Or we can say by truth and reality. Because what we see in terms of the material earth and the skies, there is a true reality of the earth and the sky that is already created prior to that manifestation. That's why we can say he created the heavens and the sky in truth and reality, by truth and reality. Because the truth and reality was created before the manifestation of the material world. وَسَوَّرَكُمْ, and He gave us, gave you your picture, your true picture. Fa'asana suwarakum. And he makes most excellent your picture. You don't have to change it. He made it. Allah made our picture, and he made our picture most excellent. If we compare our picture with any other picture, our picture is more excellent. Wa ilayhi al-masir, and to him is the, we could say, the becoming. That's how I would say it, the becoming. It is Allah, from this verse, that shapes and forms us in the womb of the mother. This is our original created form, our original created character, our original picture is formed in the womb. Before we come in contact with anything else that will have an influence over this picture, this character, this creation, it belongs to Allah. There is the principle that is working in us, both male and female, and both are reproduced from the other. The male comes from the female, and the female comes from the male. The male principle produces the female, and the female principle produces the male. And hear the word principle. Sometimes I'm saying things and we miss the key words, and we get thrown off because our minds are conditioned to think like this world teaches us, or this society teaches us to think. Just as the night comes out of the day, and the day comes out of the night. In the male and female form, we come out of the womb as African, Chinese, European, Indian, etc., with the various colors, height, hair textures, shapes, etc. However, we know that these are not the more important identities when sitting at the table of humanity. The only time that I would suggest that you put your physical description on your resume. Normally, when we fill out a resume, they don't ask for a physical description. But if you're applying for the NBA, I would advise you to put on that black and 7 foot. It may have merit. But otherwise, we don't do that, do we? We should think about how Islam, these ideas in the Quran, has already influenced the American public instead of always being anti-American with Islam. Everything in America is not bad. And Islam has had a big influence. The Quran has had a big influence in the world, and we should be looking to see where that influence is, that we don't have to change it. We know you can be born appearing the same in physical looks, but more unlike each other, just as a brother or sister can be born twins and are unlike each other. What I'm saying is that we are not going to be the same in knowledge and behavior just because we appear physically the same. While at the same time, we can have common knowledge and behavior, yet We have never met or seen each other before. A man on one side of the globe can have a body of knowledge, and this is proven. And on another side of the globe, a man can have the same kind of body of knowledge. And out of that knowledge, the man on this side of the globe can build things. On this side, the man can build something very similar. But they had never met each other. It doesn't mean that the man started after he traveled all the way to South America and he built those the monuments, the temples or what have you in South America. It doesn't mean that. It means that they have been created from the same source. And they have a common identity before they were South American or African. Before. We also know that we can group all of us together as having one picture that we all identify by, and that picture is the human picture. Something in us that is common to our original creation. That's how we should begin to view our human picture. We can claim unity by this picture before we claim to be anything else in our diversities. That's what we should be looking at first if we're going to claim unity. From this human picture, we can say that we have mates, bringing about the advancement of life in the humanity, and those mates are the intellect or the conscience of man and the nature. Those are the mates. Both are working for the life and advancement of mankind. We see the female principle operating as the nature in its purity, or the religious body that stays in its purity is a good picture resembling the purity of nature which gives birth to consciousness. It is the original nature in which the conscious intellect is born. Then that intellect works to improve upon the nature, have an influence upon the nature, that it would have a greater freedom and dignity in the world for the life of the nature. We come from the nature, and we will return to the nature. And this nature is already in an ordered process in creation, that if we get out of the proper pattern that Allah wants for us, when we die from this world, we will be put automatically back in that proper order, that proper pattern. We return to it. You think we're going to be able to take our sinful selves that we have taken ourselves intellectually outside of what God has intended for us from being born out of its original nature? You think when you die, we die, we're going to take that with us and have influence? No, you can see right there. The friction that you're going to cause by that is going to burn you up. We act out these principles in our social life in order to help us remember. This is how we bring about the good social life. We base it upon these universal principles that are already operating in nature and creation. And this will guarantee us a successful life, because we'll be patterning our social life on what Allah has already created. We may translate this idea into the social life, saying that the male is born out of the female as a sign that the thinker the intellect, the conscious one, is born out of the community, that it stands over the community and protects, educates, directs the community into having more freedom and dignity in the life of itself. This is the sign that we have in community and leadership. Nature will awaken the conscious only. And once the conscious is awakened and it's supposed to study nature to bring about its improvement. And we can bring about improvement. Man is the last thing that's created. Not the first thing, it's last. There's the summation it holds in it, the summation of everything else that was created before. And man himself is the one who improves that upon which he was created, to the point he may even think himself as God. And sometimes he does make that mistake. But he's not God. Once a thing enters your conscience and you become aware of it and accept it, then you have to become responsible for it. Isn't that the Khalifa? Whatever you carry in your mind, and you recognize what you are carrying in your mind, whether you understand it fully or not, you are responsible for it. Allah has placed responsibility in our original creation. When he's making man, he's placing in man this idea, this concept, this principle of responsibility is in all of us. The intellect is given responsibility when it is giving birth, when it has been given birth by Mother Nature. Allah wants all of us to be Khalifa, both male and female. To translate what we're saying in today's social climate is that just as mama is not always going to be responsible for you as an individual, the white community or another community is not always going to be responsible for you as an African-American former slave. We have to grow up and become responsible for ourselves, for our own actions and behavior. Once consciousness comes to the intellect, and as I say, this speech is not just for you sitting here, but we welcome those who are listening to us through the media. This media that we're used to looking at, the media that we give our attention to, is the Satan. That's the Satan right there. The biggest Satan in our society is the media. And we should never allow the media to define who we are. We should allow Allah to define who we are. It's not right. It's not justice for someone who creates us not to be the someone that we allow to define us. And we allow someone else to define us. To the point, they would have us thinking that we don't have African-American examples today that doesn't meet their statistics of an African-American in jail or on drugs or criminal. When we have a whole society of African-Americans that's not of that character. But how many of us will look at them and say, you know, We ought to be like them. Now we look at them and say, think they're better than us. Some of y'all correct me because we have a couple of Arab brothers. They'll be up here soon, probably. You shouldn't talk like this in front of them. Well, I went to their shop one day. They got a shop 2 doors down, a couple of doors down. They come for Juma. And they got a shop in Oak Park. So I go to the shop in Oak Park, the fish place, get a couple of fish sandwiches. So soon I walk in, they start laughing with each other. They say, hey, here's the man. They say, you know, boom. I'm here to get a fish sandwich. I don't teach history and all of that on the street. I go get what I got to get, I go home. I'm old now, I can't be making all these shifts and changes. So I said, yeah, I know more. Is it more likes you? More than right? I said, okay. Since you opened the door for a conversation, I said, well, how's business? How's business up here? He says, you know, I listen to how he has to say this to me. Because more than told him about me. So if I can dish it out, they figure he can take it. So they say, you know, up here, the customers up here, you see how those customers are waiting? They'll wait a half hour for their order. And they'd be so quiet and won't say nothing. But down in Detroit, 5 minutes, and all hell breaks loose. Now he didn't say African Americans or any of that. He allowed my imagination to take over, and I understand what he's saying. Here's a group of African Americans that are waiting. They won't say nothing. They'll wait patiently for their sandwich. It would take a half hour. But here's another group, they can't take 5 minutes. And they loud, so they get loud and crazy, and problems start. So what am I saying? I'm just saying, why don't the ones over here become a good example for the ones over here on their behavior? Why can't media show us that? No, they have all of us thinking. We loud and crazy, acting. And we don't know any better, and we too use that as an excuse for our behavior. Most of us sitting here right now listening to me is not of that group. But we pretend. We pretend to be ignorant and don't understand and can't do for ourselves. That's the group that knows better. We live in well-ordered family settings. We pay all our bills, our taxes. We make plans. We plan for vacations, for cruises, for trips. But when we come here, and in this environment, we act like we don't know nothing. We give it all up. Because we always feel that someone else is going to take care of us. Even though we have met the qualifications of being responsible for our own self. We don't put it in the group. We don't bring it to the group. When we do not have good leadership in our life, when the leadership becomes dead or corrupt, we have to hold to the best of our nature until nature produces out of it a good leader. Now, you know, I'm not letting anything go, because I'm too old, I might not have time to say it. You know how when someone passes away, you say, oh man, I didn't have time to go by to see the brother. Well, I may not have time to say what I have to say, so I'm saying it. I can only hear out of one ear. You should know personal things about the man, you know, a leader or a person. I can only hear out of one ear. That means I have to be conscious of what I'm listening to. I have to make sure it reaches my conscience. Because I can't be paying attention to something over here and hearing something over here. I can only give conscience to what I want to hear. So if there's only one person speaking, I have to give my ear to that person. Right? So, you can't humble me yourself because you didn't create me as a leader. If I come and tell you have a good leader, I'm telling you you have a good leader. If you don't recognize it, you have a good leader. That's not arrogant. It's ego, yes, because the leader should be able to put you in check. When that E takes over, when these pleasure principles take over, you need something to put you in check. So we need an ego. Our ego was taken from us in slavery. And we have people running around now saying, kill your ego, give me your ego, reduce your ego. The ego is only bad when I walk in this room, I only see me and I don't see the others. That's when the ego has a problem. But if I come here and I say, here I am standing here, and I see you there, and I know something about you and your background, let me address it. I have no problem with the ego then. The ego should be strong. But if I come here, brothers, sisters, just whatever y'all want to do, whatever y'all like, we just go ahead and just inshallah, inshallah. That's the one whose ego has been destroyed. And your own mother don't want to see you like that. And if the nature becomes corrupt, then we no longer recognize her in her purity of motherhood, then we have to fast from this world's knowledge and behavior and pray that we be reborn all over again as a people. We have to pray for God's intervention. And that is what has happened to us. And that's what happened to Muhammad the Prophet. And that is what happened to Jesus, the Son of Mary. May Allah's prayers and peace be upon all of them. If we study them, that's what happened. We have this principle operating in us as a ritual. It is in the ninth month called Ramadan that we are in our mother's womb looking forward to our first birth. The birth of our good nature and our pure nature. That's our first birth. If we were to say, is it the male or the female created first? It would be logical to say the female, not the male. Because we think it would be better off if we're born out of nature instead of nature being born out of us. We are born with revelation that is prepared to enter into our conscience. We already have the Quran in us. All of us, the Quran is already written in our nature. It's already inscripted. And all we need is one of us, of the human family, just one, to be able to read the script and allow it to come into the intellect. We don't need five. Just one. Then after three periods of revelation, our intellect experiences a bright light. If you learn to read the Quran, and I'm speaking from experience now, if you learn to read the Quran, the original Quran for yourself, it is designed for the bright light to come on automatically. It's designed for you to think. You have to You have to pause and think. It's designed that way. You can't speed read it. You can't read it fast. You have to pause. But they teach us artificial pauses. How to recite and put a little mark for the pause. Long pause, short pause, continue. Those are artificial pauses. The true pause is when the revelation is coming to the intellect, you have to stop and think. What did I just say? And then read more. Or what does this have to do with what I just said? You have to pause because it can't run on. It looks like it's running on. It's written like it's running on. But believe me, it's not running on like that. You have to. That's how Allah teaches us. When you begin reading, and you get better at reading, after a while, you're not reading the Quran is being read to you. Yes, and a light comes on. A bright light comes on from the reading. Our light becomes complete again, and with the purity of nature and enlightenment, both coming together in the form of taqwa and fujur, if you know Arabic. But I just say it, purity of nature and enlightenment. We come down from the high ascending order because the Quran will get you high. But you don't have hangovers. But you're not drunk. Yes. Jesus, and we're going to continue this Sunday. He was with his students. Come to students or disciples, either one. And he gave them some bread. Right? He said, take this. This is my body. That's what Jesus said. Y'all remember? Mm-hmm. He had something in the cup. He didn't say what was in the cup. Not in this verse. He said he took the cup and he gave the cup and he said, then all of you drink. Now, he said, this is my blood, the New Testament. That's how he defined himself. Right? Now, in that cup, what he had in that cup, supporting what I'm saying now, will get you high. But it won't intoxicate you. You won't be drunk. But you have to come down from that high. What we call that ascension, and build a good community life that will preserve and reproduce from that life. I pray that you understand. Alhamdulillah, Rabbil Alameen.
Thank
Alhamdulillah Rabbil Alameen. Wassalatu wassalamu ala rasulihi wa ala ahli wa ala sahbihi wa ala al-muslimin wa al-mu'minin ajma'in. Amma ba'd. Dear believers, let me make a comment about the business life, because we have to have support in our business life. And we started out as our, use the word peddlers, as I'm saying. So we have different products downstairs that some of us have, we're selling. And we have Brother Mikhail. Yeah, Mikhail is here. We know Brother Mikhail. If you don't, you'll meet Brother Mikhail. We know his mother, we know his parents. I knew Mikhail when he was riding around in a stroller. I can picture right now his parents pushing him in the stroller. But somewhere along the line, when I talk to him today, consciousness has entered into his intellect.
and he is responsible for himself. That's how Allah made us. So he sells shirts. Shirts. Now, I purchased a shirt from him, a sweatshirt. He had different shirts. All of us wear shirts, right? And many of us may or may not wear a sweatshirt. We may have our preference. But this is how we get started, isn't it? We become a nest for the businessman. A nest right here. And we have to learn this. In this nest, I might suggest to him, look, since you're in the shirts, well, first of all, if we wear a sweatshirt, we should buy a sweatshirt from him. And he makes his own shirts with the designs on them. And he has good, he's very confident and have good speech to identify his customer base. And he has good choice of words. So he has shirts for the urban man. Now I have to think, you know, who and what is the urban man? Well, that's the, well, y'all know who the urban man is. But he has, that's how he identifies his customers. I've been in retail before, so I know a little bit of what I'm talking about. But also, he can expand, the possibility of expanding. So we start out buying a sweatshirt from him. And maybe we don't like the urban design. I don't want urban designs on my clothes. I want a different design, so he'll put a different design on the sweatshirt, right? Especially if many of us don't mind having the same design, like MWM, like historic MWM. He'll make a 4 or 5 of those if we buy them. Little things like that, or a little golf shirt like. Look, something that's casual, but yet still look dressy. See, this is where we start. This is how people get started with the businesses that they have and have longevity in their businesses. But he has to listen to his customer base, and his customer base also have to be ready to support him. So I can make an order and therefore, look at this shirt I got. I like shirts. Y'all should know that by now. I don't have a lot of shirts because I don't have a lot of money. But I like shirts. If I have a lot of money, I can't afford a suit. I got one suit. I can't keep wearing that suit to Juma, because then I can't wear that suit to dinner. But if I wear that suit once every 6 months to a dinner, I'm all right. Right? One suit, 2 shirts, 4 or 5 ties. The ties make the difference. I hook it up with my wife's dress, but she got many dresses. I hook my tie with the dress, and everybody be so much on the tie and the dress, they don't realize that's the same suit they had on last time. This is business. This is home business. Right? But look, if I say to him, look, make a shirt, get a shirt like this, I buy another. It's nice and long, it covers us, it meets the Islamic social requirement for wearing clothes. We're to have our private part covered, men and women. The same dress for the women is the same for the man. Only one thing was added to cover the breasts for the women. Everything else is the same. When we look at our president, when he comes into the public, we only see what? His face and his hands in his dress. Have we ever seen him any other way? Do we ever see him with a t-shirt? Do we ever see him with his arms out? Do we ever see him with other parts of his body out showing? No, that's the best dress, that's the most proper dress, and that's the influence of Islam on America. That's how we're to dress. But we can create our own fashion. Don't get hung up on fashion. We can create our own in fashion, but yet still meeting the requirement. So, check him out. Start with a sweatshirt, and then we grow into other shirts. Right?
Don't do that.
Also, we want to remind us, we have to raise the money for the bus for Savior's Day. And for many of us, most of us, and for all of us, Savior's Day should be important. We want a group of seniors here, they want to go to Savior's Day, and we want to get a bus. The bus is $2,200 that we need to raise. And I know we have enough people here to help donate to to raise the money to get the bus. Only a few that can afford it. Because we have a responsibility. A responsibility to the community that we're in. We have that responsibility. Because of the importance of Savings Day. Now, some of us are very Islamically astute now. We're gonna say, there's no such thing as Savings Day. Yes, it is. Allah says, save yourself and your family from the fire. That's what Allah says. Save yourself and your family. So there are those, a group of individuals that have come in our family to save us from the fire. Or, as I've said in the khutbah, Allah intervened as they came and saved us from the fire. So this is important for us. It's one day that we as a people should reflect upon ourselves. Every people have that. Don't let anyone think that a people don't have that. Yes, when we all come together as different people, no, we don't focus in on one, but when we're together as a family, don't tell me that you ain't never heard of a family reunion. Don't tell me that you get at the family reunion and you talk about your family. And you rehearse how you came together as a family. But you don't go talk about my family at your reunion. But when we get together, it's not about my family anymore. We have to see something greater that's common in us. So that's what I'm talking about. We, every year, we should come together and we should reflect upon our family as African Americans, how we got here, where we come from, and where we're going. Everybody should be like that. If you find someone's not like that, let me know and I'll show you people that's lost. They can become subject to be anybody. And we need that more in America than anywhere else. Whether you're African American, Pakistani, Arab, regardless, you have a responsibility, and I know you do it, to remind your children and everyone else in your house who they are and where they're from and how they got the way they are. Some of the people will speak their own language in the house and speak English outside the house just to preserve their families. Some of them will hold on to what we call their old country ways. Oh, granddad, that's the old country. But still holding on because they don't have the value in their family life today. So don't tell me what we're doing is un-Islamic. What we're doing is natural. But Allah says, like you remember your forefathers, remember me more. Never does Allah say, don't remember them. And we don't follow them when they were wrong. Yes, that's important for us. And we should not lose it. There's a brother, he come from Africa. He lived in Ghana. And they were interviewing him. And he was saying when he grew up in Ghana, everybody was black. You know, you see people like me. Everybody was black. Everybody ate the same kind of food. You know, same politics. When he went to Saudi Arabia to study, he began to see different people. But when he got to America, for the first time, it struck him. It struck his mind that he see everybody. All the people in the world, he's seeing. You see what it's doing to his mind? He come from a place, he don't see nothing but black people. Now he see everybody. He said, but out of all of this, the strangest thing that I saw where a group of Muslims were African Americans and they trying to look like they somebody else that they're not. That was the strangest thing that struck his mind. But to think about that, sometimes somebody outside got to tell them what they see. We don't see it. So what am I saying? Let us have Savior's Day, let us buy shirts, and let us be who we are. As Muslim Americans. Allahumma salli ala Muhammad wa ala ali Muhammad. Kama salaita ala Ibrahim wa ala ali Ibrahim. Innaka Hamidum Majid. Allahumma barik ala Muhammad wa ala ali Muhammad. Kama barakta ala Ibrahim wa ala ali Ibrahim. Innaka Hamidum Majid. Alhamdulillah rabbil alamin. Remember, you can get the copy of the khutbah in the office after Jummah. Iqamatu salat.
Allahu Akbar, Allahu Akbar. Ashhadu an la ilaha illallah, ashhadu anna Muhammadan rasulullah, ashhadu anna Rasulullah, ashhadu anna Rasulullah. Hayya salat, hayya salat, hayya salat, hayya salat. Ka ka salat, ka ka salat. Allahu Akbar, Allahu Akbar. La ilaha illallah.
Allahu Akbar. السلام عليكم ورحمة الله. السلام عليكم ورحمة الله.
السلام عليكم ورحمة الله.
السلام عليكم ورحمة الله.
With Surah 87, in the Quran, chapter 87. And before we continue, we want to go over the basic fundamental rules of the Arabic for the Arabic students. We have three kinds of words in the Arabic language. We have nouns, verbs, and particles. Nouns, they name a thing. The verbs, they indicate an action that has occurred in the past, or that occurs as we speak, and to the future. And we have the future, that the action occurs after we speak. And particles, they normally do not have specific meanings until they're used with a noun, verb, or another particle. If the noun ends in a dhamma, it is the subject, the thing that's being spoken of, or it is directly influenced by the subject. If a noun is in fatha, it's influenced by a verb. And if the noun ends in kasra, it's influenced by a preposition. The verbs, we have the past tense, the present tense, and the future. In the present tense, the mood changes to become either subjunctive, meaning that the mood is based upon something else occurring, or it's Joseph, it has more of a commanding spirit in the action. The action has more of a commanding spirit to it. So we began reading. This we went over in our last lesson. We began with Sabbih, Sabbih isma Rabbika al-A'la. And we are saying glorify, glorify. How do we glorify? The name of your Lord, by keeping the course that Allah had designed for man. And that's in our lessons. That's in our whole discussion. Staying on the course that Allah has designed for the human being. Alladhi, who khalaqa, who created, fasawwa, then he equalized, we are saying. He equalized. Meaning that he has put in the soul, in the creation of the soul, he has placed in it the equality. And he has placed in it the justice. And he has placed in it the freedom. Fasawwa. So we have said last week, Fasawwa, that he created, then he granted freedom, justice, and equality in the soul of every individual in order for that individual to make progress. The soul has to be free, truly free. The soul has to be just, and the soul has to have equality. And what's the equality that we have mentioned in the soul? Faith and knowledge. These are like two twins. They are twins that's placed in the soul of every individual that God gives every soul. And one is the faith or the obedience to know his Lord and to obey his Lord. And God puts in every soul the capacitance for learning. And they have to stay equal, parallel in the soul. Faith and learning. And we have to be free. Free means that we have to presuppose that every individual has in him or her the capacity to obey God without someone lording over it. That no people should be over another people to command or direct them or to be a lord over them in religion, to make it simple. And we says, we said last week, Walladhi, we're going over what we went over last week. Walladhi, and that which. See, God is being mentioned as that which. Qaddara. This is Qaddara, the second form for our Arabic students. It's in the second form. And this Shadda here makes it strong. This makes it strong, put emphasis on it. Qaddara. So not only does Allah create the soul and balances the soul, but he empowers the soul. And this is every individual. We say, your Lord, the individual, your Lord. So he empowers it. How does he empowers the soul? By causing the soul to move. It is the spirituality that moves the spiritual world. The spirituality that moves the material world. The material world does not move on its own. The body that we have, this material body that we have, does not move on its own. There's a spirituality in us that moves the body. And it has great power. Qaddara. It has great power, as our NAACP, our colored people, remind us of. Power beyond measure. They didn't bury colored people now. They buried the N-word. Colored people still alive. It's a very small issue, isn't it? Very small issue. Why the N-word? Let's take a break. Let's talk about this power. Power beyond measure. The N-word. As though the whole word don't come up in your mind when I say the N-word. The N-word was a word that was mispronounced. Niger. Everyone knows the Niger River? The Niger River, great river in Africa. Now, I don't know. We're going to have to research this. But the slaves that they must have gotten from the Niger area, maybe they were the lazy ones that laid around under the trees all day. And maybe they didn't want them Nigers. When you go get you some slaves and bring them back over here to sell them, don't bring me no Nigers. Bring me some Ghanaians or something. Or Moroccans. But I don't want none of them Nigers. And maybe they just start mispronouncing the word Niger. Right? But they stopped calling us Nigers. But we popularized it. Our own youth popularized it. And I'm saying it's a small issue the way it's being addressed, because we have to look and see what makes our youth act like they act. What makes them cry out